we have acquired notions of subjectivity and identity and self-realization, which are inherently unsustainable in that they incorporate ideals of flexibility and ongoing reconstruction, that is, in that they are not intended to be sustained, but intended to be constantly reconfigured, in that they are strongly consumption-based and resource-intensive, and in that they are not generalizable, and in the context of finiteness, based on social inequality and, for God's sake, exclusion. That's good. Nevertheless, being emancipatory achievements rather than pathological deformations, these norms are adamantly being defended. And once we have acknowledged that second-order emancipation moves us into a new eco-political era, the era of post-ecologist politics, we can begin to explore in more detail, firstly, what an eco-politics that no longer has any normative point of reference outside the system of consumer capitalism will actually look like. Such an eco-politics becomes fully self-referential. It can only be an eco-politics that seeks to sustain the established order and that seeks to build resilience. And secondly, we can begin to explore how the politics of unsustainability politically legitimates and practically organizes the management of ever higher levels of social inequality, injustice, and exclusion on which it is inevitably and invariably based. In this regard, the depoliticization of the ecological issue that Eric was talking about and the individualization of responsibility that Buzz was talking about are, I think, two key strategies or two key practices. And the same applies to the form of political reaction that we adopt or position that we adopt towards populist movements, which are branded as irrational, ideological, and right-wing extremist, and on these grounds are then excluded from the sanitized political arena. That's it. Thanks very much.